All right, good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study here at Sierra Norwood Calvary Baptist Church. We're going to go ahead and get started, and we're going to ask Sister Ayanna to open us in a word of prayer, please.
Okay. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for another week that we can come together and dive into your word. I pray, Lord, that you give us a revelation, a word in time, a word in season. May it not just be something we hear, but something that we also digest, so to speak, and that will enable those who are listening to grow closer to you and grow in understanding of you, Lord. We just thank you for the blessing of Brother Chisholm and this time that we have with him, Lord. I pray that you continue to use him in our congregation and continue to bless him, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we come to you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Everybody here knows the rules. You know, we ask you to mute as we go on. If you have questions, just wave your hand or use a little icon or put it in the chat, and we will acknowledge it and acknowledge you so you can ask your question or make your statement or your comment to Reverend Chisholm, who doesn't mind being interrupted. I don't have any, on the top of my head, any announcements for this week, except for hope to see you on Sunday, God willing, 10:55. And we'll go ahead and turn it over to you, Reverend Chisholm.
Right. Good evening again, brethren. So we're continuing reading the Bible meaningfully. The last two tracks will be played in a minute's time by Damien. What I'll take you through the handout I sent, I'm just going to pull a little section from it, has to do with idioms and figures of speech, which is essentially track three. So go ahead, Damien. Play track three. We go to track three and four, and then we'll have your Q&A right after. I'll point out the sections on the handout, sharing it, and then we go to your Q&A.
Here we go.
Figures of speech, our next concern, are colorful, non-literal ways of speaking or writing that play important roles in all literature and are especially prominent in poetic literature. Reading the Bible meaningfully demands that we develop the ability to detect where figures of speech are used. There are many figures of speech used in the Bible, but we mention just a few of the simpler and more popular ones. You are familiar, no doubt, with the figures of comparison that we call similes and metaphors. So we begin with these. A simile is a comparison between two things or two actions in which one is said to be as or like the other. So in Psalm 42 and verse 1, we read, "As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God." In this simile, this comparison, the soul's desire for God is compared with a deer's desire for water. Here's another example in Proverbs 11 and verse 22. "Like a gold ring in a pig's snout is a beautiful woman who shows no discretion." Here, the oddness of a beautiful woman without discretion is likened to the oddness of a gold ring in a pig's snout. The writer's meaning easily comes across in this comparison. Now, the metaphor also compares, but there is no like or as to readily tell you that there is a comparison. A good example of this is found in Luke 13 and verse 32, where Jesus says concerning Herod Antipas, "Go tell that fox." Since Herod is not literally a furry, four-footed animal, then our Lord seemed to have been comparing Herod's characteristic craftiness or Ananciism with that of a fox. When you are dealing with similes and metaphors, make sure you do not push the comparisons too far or in too many directions, because usually there is only one point of comparison or a likeness between the two things that the figure of speech emphasizes. You may need to note as well that when a simile is developed into a story, it becomes a parable. You do remember that our Lord's parables have some expression of comparison, such as, "The kingdom of heaven is like," or, as in the case of the parable of the Samaritan in Luke chapter 10, from verse 30 onwards, "to behave like," or "to behave as a neighbor, you behave as or like the Samaritan." Hence, at the end of the parable, after the lawyer had correctly identified who it was that behaved as neighbor, Jesus said to him in verse 37, "Go and do likewise." So a simile developed into a story becomes a parable. Now, when a metaphor is developed into a story, we get an allegory. There's a lovely romantic allegory in Proverbs 5, verses 15 to 23, where sexual intimacy and marital faithfulness are depicted as drinking from one's own cistern or well. There is a stated allegory in Galatians chapter 4, verses 22 and the following verses. Another figure of speech that can be misread or misunderstood is the hyperbole, spelt hyperbole. This is when a writer or speaker consciously exaggerates or overstates a case to increase the effect of what is being said. A non-biblical example in our regular speech is like smilingly but firmly telling someone that if she divulges a secret shared with her, you are going to kill her. You do not literally mean that you will take her life. You are using a hyperbole. You are exaggerating for effect. Just like when we see a good-sized crowd and say, "Man, there were millions of people there." We don't literally mean millions. What we want to convey is that it was a very, very large crowd. A classic hyperbole in the Bible is in Matthew 5 and verse 29, where Jesus says, quote, "If your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away," unquote. If you take that literally, you will end up as a cyclops. What Jesus is emphasizing by the exaggeration is the need to deal decisively with whatever causes one to sin. Another figure of speech deserves mention, the euphemism, spelled euphemism. A euphemism is a nicer, softer way of saying something that is offensive, disagreeable, or indelicate. In our speech, we may see someone whom we regard as ugly and describe that one as not so handsome or not exactly comely. That's a euphemism. Or notice how we use washroom or bathroom for toilet. That's also using a euphemism. Now in Judges chapter 3 and verse 24, and in 1 Samuel 24 and verse 3, we read of a man covering his feet. This is a euphemism for going to the toilet or passing feces, because his garments would fall around his feet as he stooped down. A last word on the proverb. This is a brief, memorable, wise saying that has wide application, but should not be taken as an inflexible rule for every situation without exception. This is highlighted in Proverbs 26, 4 to 5, where one verse says, "Do not answer a fool according to his folly," and the other says the exact opposite. What's happening here? You apply each in context or when it is appropriate. There are times when you answer a fool to help the fool. At other times, silence with a fool might be helpful for the fool.
Go on to the next track, please.
Okay. Okay.
Let us now turn to reading the Gospels meaningfully. The first four books of the New Testament are called Gospels. And because they deal basically with the life and ministry of Jesus, one might wonder why they are not called biographies or histories. Although the Gospels contain biographical elements and large chunks of history, they do not qualify as biographies or histories in the modern sense of both terms. A gospel is, in essence, a theological biography or theological history. What do we mean by this? Simply, a gospel is an account of the ministry of Jesus, designed to prompt faith in Jesus as Son of God, Messiah, or Savior. Each gospel writer shares selected aspects of Jesus' ministry from his own particular perspective, with his own particular slant, with his own emphases. As you read the Gospels, do remember that the writer may be giving you either the essence or a summary of what Jesus said, a paraphrase of what he said, or at times the exact words that Jesus uttered. Though it might be somewhat disturbing for certain Christians, we must grapple with the fact that the differences in detail that we find in the gospel writers as they deal with the same subject strongly suggest that the gospel writers were often more concerned with the essence of an incident or statement than with minute detail or word-for-word accuracy. Researchers tell us that only 5% of the people of the first century could read and write, and that in such a culture, accuracy means something like rendering the tradition in a way that is faithful. That's what you have in the Gospels. People passing on sayings, stories, and the like, attempting to be faithful to the tradition, but not aiming for word accuracy. So as you read the Gospels, try to find out what the writer intended to convey through the account that he wrote. Bearing in mind that the Gospel writers were far more concerned about the essence of what Jesus said than about capturing his exact words. Most of the books of the New Testament are called epistles. These are letters written in response to needs existing in a church situation, even though a few of the epistles are addressed to individuals. The epistles are often misread or misused because we approach them as if they were theological textbooks or religious reference books that give comprehensive treatment of topics. Let me emphasize that each epistle was occasioned by the historical needs or concerns of some group of believers somewhere in the first century church. If we are to read the epistles meaningfully, then we must do so with certain guidelines. First, since they are letters, read them as whole letters, not in a piecemeal fashion by selecting a verse or chapter here or there today and then come back again next week or next month. Nobody who receives a four-page letter begins by reading page 3, then weeks later goes to page 4, and so on in a haphazard manner. To get the full force and to capture the proper meaning of the letter, you begin at page 1 and read straight through to page 4. We should treat the epistles like that and read each one straight through as a whole. This way, you can appreciate the writer's emphases and concerns. By the way, do you realize that when the biblical writers wrote, they did not use chapter and verse divisions? No. The divisions into chapter and verse were done much later to help later readers understand blocks of thought. So, were we to read the material just after it was done by the biblical writers, we would have been forced to begin at the beginning and take each book straight through in sequence. A second guideline is to read the epistles and remember that each is written in light of the historical realities of some church group. Knowing something about the realities of the first readers of the epistles could make your reading that more meaningful. For instance, one could get the mistaken idea that the Philippian church was a problem-free, joyful church because of the repeated emphases on joy in the epistle. Well, drawing on 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 to 5, we know that the Philippian church was poor but generous. Look also at Philippians chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. When you read between the lines a bit in Philippians 4, 10 to 19, you discover that the church was facing anxiety because of financial problems. The encouragement in Philippians 4 to fret about nothing and be content in whatever circumstance is designed to calm the real anxious hearts of the believers at Philippi. Helpful material about the historical background of each epistle can be found in study Bibles, like the New International Version Study Bible, or in commentaries. These are books that provide commentary on or explanations of the books of the Bible. The final kind of literature that we wish to deal with is prophecy. By prophecy, we mean those sections of Scripture that make promises and predictions for the future. Do bear in mind that a biblical prophet was involved not only in foretelling or predicting, but also in forthtelling, that is, declaring boldly the mind of God. In terms of predictive material, in the Bible, we are talking about some 27% of the Bible. The Bible contains about 31,124 verses. There are approximately 8,352 verses of predictive material, covering some 737 separate prophetic topics. The only books without predictive material are Philemon, 3 John, Ruth, and Song of Songs. Predictive material in the Bible requires very great care if we are to read meaningfully. It is so very easy to go overboard in deciding absolutely that something in the predictive section of the Bible is being fulfilled before our very eyes or in our day. A few basic guidelines should help you in your reading. Prophecies generally fall into one of three categories: unconditional, conditional, or sequential. An unconditional prophecy or promise relates to what is to be in a totally God-controlled way and is not dependent for fulfillment on any human being's response. Two examples might assist you. Take the case concerning the seasons in Genesis 8, 21 and 22, and that concerning the new covenant in Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through to 34. A conditional prophecy or promise relates to what is to be if, that is, its fulfillment depends on human response one way or another. Compare the situation in Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy chapters 28 through 32, where obedience would result in one thing and disobedience in another thing. The underlying principle of a conditional prophecy or promise is clear in Jeremiah 18, verses 7 to 10. In a sequential prophecy or promise, several events are brought together in one prediction, even though they will be fulfilled in a sequence and a series of acts, sometimes stretching over several centuries. A good example is the prophecy concerning the destruction of Tyre recorded in Ezekiel 26, verses 3 to 14, and chapter 29, verses 17 to 20. In Ezekiel 26 and verse 3, we learn that many nations would come against Tyre. And in verse 7, Babylon, through Nebuchadnezzar, is mentioned as one of those many nations. But the sequential element can be missed if we fail to see that verses 8 to 11 speak with the singular he, but verse 12 uses the plural they. What happened historically brings out the sequence. Nebuchadnezzar, around 573 BC, geographically displaced Tyre, though he did not succeed in destroying it completely. It was the Macedonian Alexander the Great who in 323 BC, and in fulfillment of Ezekiel 26:12, completed the destruction of Tyre. So far, we have explored numerous pointers on reading the various kinds of literature in the Bible. What needs to be said now is a word on reading meaningfully, in a personal sense, or reading the Bible devotionally. The best summary of the devotional use of the Bible that I have read comes from Merrill Tenney. He says that the devotional study of the Bible is not so much a technique as a spirit. It is the spirit of eagerness which seeks the mind of God. It is a spirit of humility which listens to the voice of God. It is a spirit of adventure which pursues earnestly the will of God. It is a spirit of adoration which rests in the presence of God. When you read the Bible, prayerfully desire to hear from God and determine to do what He asks of you. It should have become clear to you that reading the Bible meaningfully requires diligent and serious work. I would encourage you to develop the habit of a regular and systematic study of the Bible. And I want to close with a few suggestions for you to use. There are some basic resources that you will need for your study. These will include a version of the Bible in more modern English. If you can afford it, having a few such versions is helpful for comparison. You will also need a good Bible dictionary. The New Bible Dictionary is a good investment for your library. The Bible Dictionary will help you with the meaning of certain words or shed light on biblical customs, etc. Then you will also need some commentaries. If you are low on funds, you may wish to begin with a one-volume commentary like the New Bible Commentary and buy additional commentaries as you are able, depending on which book of the Bible you are studying. A good concordance is usually quite handy for your personal Bible study. If you want to know where in the Bible a word is used, you go to a concordance for that. The more complete concordances like Young's or Strong's will list all the references for every word in the Bible as taken from the King James Version. There are, of course, concordances that are linked to other versions. A critical tool in your personal Bible study is a notebook, preferably something durable. To begin your study program, You need to decide whether you're going to study a theme, a word, or a section of a book, or a whole book. In the beginning, though, start with something that fires your interest, or something that is of concern to you. This will certainly help to keep you going in your study. I would suggest that you start with the Bible alone, and as you prayerfully explore the text of Scripture, write down what you observe that you think is important for you to ponder. Notice repeated words and phrases, troublesome words that you may need to look up in a Bible dictionary. Write down as well questions about the text that come to your mind as you read. Later on, you can see what a commentary has to say about some of the things you have noted on paper. It really helps to sustain your love for Bible study if you share with someone some of the things that you discover from your personal quiet time of study. Maybe you could even form a study group with some of your friends and share discoveries that you all make from the Bible. I pray that you will know the joy of a life lived in accordance with the principles of God's Word, and that the material we have shared has opened your appetite for a progressively deeper and more meaningful exploration of the Bible. For your personal library, I would recommend my other cassette titles. These are Introduction to the Bible, Plain Talk on Sex, Values and Integrity, Popular Music, A Christian Evaluation, The Dynamics of Hope, Rastafarianism Evaluated, Mormonism, The Resurrection of Jesus, Saturday or Sunday, Fact or Fiction, Race, Culture, and Heritage, and The Christian and the Mosaic Law. I encourage you in closing, love the Word, study the Word, and by God's grace, live the Word.
Okay, let me just add two little, pointers for your benefit. Not all of the titles I just mentioned have been converted to CDs and so would not be on my website, the Chisholm Source. But the companion to Reading the Bible Meaningfully is Introduction to the Bible, which I would highly recommend to all of you. Then in terms of commentaries, there's a real sale on Word Biblical Commentary. In my view, the leading evangelical commentary available now. Really discounted, and it's excellent material that you'll find useful until the Lord returns. So that's Word Biblical Commentary, and you might find the sale through Christian book distributors online. Real discount, because rather than take the physical books, which are discounted as well, it's much more of a bargain to go for the ebook version. So you don't have to worry about space. You have that on your flash drive or your whatever drive that can hold a lot of stuff. All right, let me just share a little piece now of the handout that you got. Just walk you through a section of it, actually. All right. Are you seeing this on screen?
No.
Not there?
Not yet, no.
All right, what do I need to do then? Come on. Let me go back. Go back out and come back in. I thought once I had clicked share, but maybe I didn't. So this, select, share. There now?
Yes.
All right, good. So I just want to do 4 and 5, just to reinforce, as it were. Watch for idioms. Idioms are peculiar ways of saying things, like the expression, saved by the skin of your teeth. Idioms, like words, change meaning over time. Imagine what the following question meant 40 years ago as opposed to today. If you ask somebody, how are the two of you making out? You might think you're invading their private life. You probably just mean, how are you surviving? How are you making it need?
Yeah.
So that expression, that idiom, does not mean the same thing years ago that it would mean to the average person today. A good commentary or a book on Bible customs can help with the meaning of idioms in Bible times. Number 5, be alert to the figurative use of language. In this regard, figures of speech play a critical role. We use it so often that it escapes us that we are using figurative or non-literal language when we say the sun rises in the east or the sun sets in the west. I think we all know that the sun neither rises nor sets. It's how it appears to us. And so it's the language of appearance that we get in that non-literal speech, which we get to the, what they call the things on the weather reports and that kind of a thing. Be aware of the most popular figures of speech, like simile, we did that. Metaphor, we just went through that. Parable, not the traditional and earthly story with a heavenly meaning. That works too, but better, a parable is a simile fleshed out in story form. Allegory, we did that. Analogies, that just a comparison, which basically is what a simile and a metaphor are. Hyperbole, exaggeration, personification is treating a non-personal thing, an inanimate thing, as if it were a person, like Paul does in Romans 8. The creation is waiting on tiptoes. Creation doesn't have toes. What he means is creation is eager for the full revelation after the second coming. And in a sense, the creation is going to benefit when the people of God have got their taste of the full blessings that God has promised to them in spite of the hardships that we are going through now. Bear in mind as well that a word derives its meaning from its use in a particular context, not so much from a dictionary. Usage is the center of how you get the meaning of a word. How does Paul use the word law in Galatians? You wouldn't go to a dictionary, a modern dictionary even, or even a Bible dictionary. Bible dictionary would be more helpful though. Just words derive meaning from context. All right, I'll open now for your questions, comments, and observations as we wind down. So let me stop share. Anybody?
I like how you shared about the idioms.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think, you know, we get caught up with that as well, trying to interpret something that, like as you put it, may have changed or become irrelevant over time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, trying to make it mean what it means now.
Right. And therefore, the original context in which that idiom was used.
Right.
First ask, what did that idiom mean to the original hearers or readers?
Right. And
then secondarily, you could ask, no, what could that possibly mean for us today?
Right.
But in Bible study, regrettably, we usually say, what does this text mean to us as our primary focus? No, we are eavesdropping on ancient texts. So we have to give the people to whom it was given first the pride of place by saying, what did they understand John to mean? What did they understand Jude to mean? And then we can secondarily ask, how relevant is that for us today? Or what is that saying to us today?
Right.
So back then first, now secondarily.
Like you were using the example, how are you making out? If you...
That's right.
If you said that, you know, 2,000 years ago, it could be something completely different than mm-hmm. what it is right now.
Yeah. My daughter and I were, and our son as well, we were kind of joking. And my family is a family of clothes, no surprise there. The chief sensible person in the family is my wife. So we're talking about silly expressions. Have you ever wondered what they mean when they say, he beat him within an inch of his life? Not 2 inches of his life. Mm-hmm. What is an inch of your life? How dead or less dead are you? Right. Inch or 2 inches. Mm-hmm. Those are expressions that we very rarely question what they do mean. We use them and we think we understand how to use them, and maybe we do use them correctly. But if somebody were to press you and say, what exactly do you mean by beat him within an inch of his life?
An inch, not 6 inches?
Yeah, not 6 inches, not 2 inches, not an inch and a half, just an inch, you know? So those are expressions that we find. The one I wrote on recently is it's an Americanism, quite frankly. I don't think I've ever heard it in Jamaica. Maybe I need to probably have moved wider. You can walk and chew gum. How difficult are those two things together? Mm-hmm. It's simple. You chew gum in your mouth, you walk with your feet.
Right.
But it's supposed to mean that you can do two difficult things at once. There's nothing difficult in chewing a gum while you're walking. People do that.
All the time, without thinking.
There's an American fellow who spat out the gum in, I keep forgetting the name of this country. Lee Kuan Yew was the, or probably still is the prime minister. Good night. It's a first world country now, but it was regarded as a third world country. They learned how to build financial institutions in Jamaica, from Jamaica. The prime minister was there. Good night. Jerry Gallimore lived there when he was world president of Youth for Christ. Cannot for the life of me remember.
Thailand?
Singapore.
Singapore, yes. This American fellow went there and spat out gum on the road. And they thrashed him. The law says, if you spit on the street, you're going to be thrashed. He went there, you know, exercising his American unclean tradition and just spit on the road. And they arrested him and flogged him. Americans were in a tizzy, but the Singaporeans couldn't care less. This is the law.
Their law, yeah.
It is publicized on the streets and in the airports and whatever. If you can't read, tough. You go there, understand what the people's laws are, and obey them. But I hear the streets are so clean, you could eat your food off the street if you have nothing else there. They are that concerned about cleanliness.
Ayana, go ahead.
So my question is, unless you can identify the figurative language, do you assume that it's literal? Because I've heard, it kind of shocked me when I heard it, but somebody I know who is a believer said the story of Jonah was figurative. Either the story of Jonah or the story of Job, one of them. And people have also said
both were literal. They teach lessons that you can probably take, you know, a cue from and build your own story. But there were factual episodes in the lives of Job and Jonah. And Job, by the way, is one of the oldest books in the Bible, oldest in the New Testament. And so the books are not arranged chronologically or by virtue of which came first in terms of time of writing. But Job is the oldest in the Old Testament.
I guess some people would say that that's not real with Job because of so many things that happened in his life at that particular time. That
yes.
It does not speak too well of God doing those things, allowing those things to happen to him.
Right, and it feels like overkill.
Yeah.
But it really happened. And he argued with God about it. In fact, when I read it, I tell students whenever I have occasion to preach on it, I say, well, all I think Job was struggling with is his incipient atheism. He was kind of losing the belief whether God is really there. And so for me, he was asking himself, no, God, I just want you to make me aware that you're really there. Set up a lawyer, set up a court scene, and I will bring my defense lawyer and you come and talk. I just want to know that you're there. So when God started to reel off his fancy question, where were you when I was doing A, B, C, D? Job said, in my view, okay, fine. Now that I know that you're there, I'm cool. It doesn't mean we're there when you were doing your thing. I just wanted to be sure that you're really here with me now. Now that you've answered, I am good to go. Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. But he had tremendous faith in God, though.
Oh, man. A man to go through all of that and still hold up and trust God is amazing. We get a little headache and we wonder, you know, why God made me human. Sing that fruitful song as if you don't know why God made you human as opposed to an angel. So we have to make sure we discern if it's literal or a figure of speech. Next week, God willing, I'll show that it is not a boast to say, I read the Bible literally. That's not a compliment necessarily. If you read a figurative passage literally, you're going to misread and misunderstand the Bible. I'll take you through a piece that I posted in the, I had published in the newspaper, in the Gleaner.
Something like that would be dangerous.
Oh, yeah. Because you end up taking literally what is figurative. Just like if you write eye offend, you gouge it up and throw it away from you. You take that literally, you end up with no eyes.
Blind people.
Yeah. I'm blind and eyeless. Blind
society, yeah.
You dig out the eye. And you would not be comely to look at either.
Or if you write an offense, you cut it off.
Precisely. Same hyperbole, exaggerated language to make a point. Deal decisively with anything that leads you into sin.
Precisely.
Yeah.
What about the book of Revelation? Because I feel like that has a mixture.
The book of Revelation has several figures in there. Grotesque images. But the cue is always listen to the interpreting angel. Interpreting angel comes at points and makes clear to John, the one who was receiving the revelation, what he was seeing with his natural eyes was grotesque, mysterious, puzzling, baffling. And the interpreting angel says, what you saw is this. And the is this, I take that philosophically, is the essence of what you're seeing is really ontologically, philosophically this. So he sees a vase or a bowl with incense coming out of it. That which you saw are the prayers of the saints. It's not just incense and smoke. So it is difficult because there are different sub-literatures in the book of Revelation. And so you have to understand, especially that book, how to read it properly. And I would highly recommend if you want to carve out the time, Vodi Bauckham has an excellent series on the whole book on YouTube. VODDIEBAUCHAM. He's a brilliant, black, bright expositor. He's an American now living in Zambia with his family.
But then, anything, you know,
by him, I highly recommend.
You know, with it goes back to what you were saying too earlier in the thing, and I wrote it down, where you're talking about most of the epistles and in the things in the New Testament, they're letters, and you have to read them as such.
Yeah, read them sequentially.
And I guess with Revelation, you know, I guess it's the same thing. Sometimes, any good believer, you say, all right, let me read a chapter a day or something like that. And then you read chapter two
in Revelation.
In Revelation, and then the explanation, say, for it is in chapter three, but then you get caught up because you only read chapter two. And then you're I don't use the word lost, but you know, you get confused in you know, what is real and what is not real, or what is literal and what is figurative.
Chapter one, chapter two, and so on. So if you have limited time or you have carved out limited time, just read the book sequentially from the beginning as well as you can until you reach the end. And mischievously usually use a romantic expression. I say, if I send you a love letter, a four-page love letter, you'd be very silly as a person whom I'm professing my love to. You start at page three, and then the next day or later you go to page four. You have not read page one yet. No, read page one, page two, page three, page four. Then you find out what this stupid boy Chisholm is trying to say to you. Otherwise, you misunderstand the letter, you misunderstand him.
Anybody else?
Question, anybody, comment, observation?
Nope, nobody else? All right. Anything else, Rev?
No, I think we can call it a night at that.
Okay. All right. Would you mind closing us in a word of prayer? And I will see. Oh, before I forget, I just had it out here. Reverend Chisholm will be doing a
public lecture.
Public lecture, that's it. And it will be on, you can get into it on Zoom. And it will be on YouTube this week, Saturday, 6 p.m., August 13th. If you're on YouTube, it's Project Probe, P-R-O-B-E, Ministries. And if you want to join via Zoom, the meeting ID is 664-136-6626. Meeting ID again, 664-136-6626. And the passcode is study, the word study, S-T-U-D-Y. All right, so that's Reverend Chisholm.
Lectures on the existence of God, nature's evidence.
Yes, Saturday, August 13th.
Microbiology and astronomy to prove the existence of God beyond reasonable doubt, as they would say in a court of law.
So if you're available, then we can support him there as well.
Amy.
Yes, Dad.
Can you put that on my phone, the information?
Yes, I can send it to you, no problem.
Yeah, please. Hi, Amy, say. Glad to see you.
Same here, Pastor. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, Amy. All right, Reverend Chisholm, if you don't mind, you might close this out in a word of prayer, please.
All right, sorry, let me just dismiss you to you, Damien. The question is awkward. Would you mind? I could say, yes, I mind.
That's true.
Close in prayer.
No, you're right. You're right.
You're my friend. Yeah.
You save yourself some hassle.
Problem when I miss, I misword a question or a statement.
That's like can versus may.
That's right.
Can you open the fridge? Of course I can.
I have the ability to do it.
Yeah, that's right.
Or you say, can I eat another muffin? You right. can, you may not.
But you're not going to get it. Yeah.
That's right.
Yes.
All right, let's pray.
Thank you.
Our Father, we give you thanks for the opportunity, the joyous opportunity of delving into your word, even though briefly tonight. We ask that you might cultivate within us a love for your word. May we desire to hear you, the desire to feed on your word. And more than anything, we ask for the grace and the strength and the empowering to live the word that we do read and understand. We pray your blessings upon us as we continue to explore your word. For Christ's sake, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Have a good night.
All right, everyone. Have a good night.
Okay. Blessings.